Yeah, and then it's again my pleasure to introduce our last speaker, Annalisa Schulle. She is a postdoctoral researcher at Max Planck Institute for Human Cognitive and Brain Science. And she will give us now an overview of how extrinsic and intrinsic excitability measures are proxies for cortical excitability beyond the motor cortex.
Thank you so much, Martin. So in the interest of time, I guess I will cut it short so we have more time for interesting discussions. Now this is more like a wrap up. What do we understand when we understand cortical excitability? The most general definition of cortical excitability is the responsiveness of the cerebral cortex to an external or internal stimulus. And these stimuli might be electrical or sensory input, and we usually operationalize them by applying TMS to the primary motor cortex and evaluate the motor responses. However, M1 excitability might not reflect, as we have heard, the cortical excitability in other cortical areas, but the evaluation of cortical excitability beyond M1 requires often more complex approaches. It might, however, be important in conditions such as epilepsy, migraine, or stroke, where patients have altered excitability patterns. So, which approaches do we have? First, we could look into behavioral readouts. Up till now, people only looked into the visual domain here. And they were looking specifically into phosphenes, like evoking phosphenes, due to TMS, or also try to impair vision during a task. What we got from this research, and there was also recent meta-analysis, was that there is a significant relationship between motor and phosphine threshold, but it's very small, and there might be a lot of other factors contributing to excitability differences. Then, as we have heard from Martin, you could use the Bolt response as a readout. People have tried this in V1 and also in DLPFC. And actually, Martin was the only one that found those response patterns here. But as we have also seen, they were super heterogeneous. So that might be the reason why other people haven't found any of these relationships. Then, as we heard from Elisa, we could look at TMS-evoked potentials. There's some studies that we're also looking into the visual cortex and also into the DLPFC. And comparing to M1 excitability, where they found a more exponential increase as a factor of stimulation dose in DLPFC and occipital cortex, there was rather a linear dose response patterns. And this also confirms that if we look into electrophysiological correlates of cortical excitability, they are distinct between M1 and other cortical areas. So then some people were wondering, do we need TMS at all to evaluate cortical excitabilities? And that's what they termed intrinsic measures as compared to extrinsic measures where we have to rely on TMS. So there's a variety of suggestions for intrinsic measures. These are mostly brain oscillation based, so you might need EEG or MEG. The message of this slide is more to see how the authors understood cortical excitability or how they validated their measures, and there's a huge variety. For example, for the exponent of the periodic component of the power spectrum, people looked into cognitive functioning in health, disease, and aging. For other measures, they looked into consciousness states, but also into excitability changes due to disease, as we see here, Alzheimer's disease, or epilepsy. And then lastly, there's the kind of recent excitability index that has been validated invasively in epilepsy patients before and after pharmacotreatment while doing direct cortical stimulation, but then also validated with healthy participants looking into wake sleep cycles. So there's a lot of different ways you could understand cortical excitability. But since we were the most interested in the last measure, we launched some pilot studies on this to see if this transfers also to other proxies for excitability. So in our first experiment, we were interested if this excitability index, according to Christian Meisel, is indicative of excitability modulations due to ITBS. We had a small pilot study where we did standard ITBS again over M1 because we still had to rely on the motor evoked potentials. So we did a simple experiment, resting state EEG, single pulse TMS, then applied the ITBS, and then did the same again. And as we can see here, looking into the excitability index of Meisel, there was a significant correlation between modulations in MEP and this intrinsic measure as suggested by Meisel and colleagues. And this was specific for real over sham. As you can see here, there's nothing for the sham group, and was also specific for other measures that have been suggested for cortical excitability. In our second experiment, we were then interested in if we could also capture these excitability changes in an experiment where we do peripheral stimulation. So here we did just stimulation with auditory white noise in 30 healthy participants that did MEG, 8 minutes during white noise exposure and 8 minutes during silence. And as you can see here, we have an increase in excitability in the middle temporal gyrus, but decreases in the prefrontal cortex. And this again was specific comparing to alpha power. And there was also a temporal component to it. So the longer people are listening to the white noise, the stronger these effects are getting. And actually, these results in the excitability are also in line with behavioral studies that had been performed by other authors before, where they show that exposure to auditory white noise increases verbal memory. So to wrap this up, there have been a lot of suggestions on how we could measure cortical excitability, intrinsic and extrinsic measures. But these measures, as we have seen, do not always converge, mostly due to their heterogeneity and validation approaches, and of course also the readout measures people have looked at. And that's why we have to, I would suggest future research has to systematically investigate on what do we understand, how do we operationalize cortical excitability at all, what do we want to know, and how do these measures relate to each other. And with this, I want to thank the main collaborators on these projects, ongoing and finished projects, and also my lab, where I see many of them in the audience. Thanks for coming, and thanks for listening.